Hello dear students, in today's lecture we will look at a few more results related to normal subgroups. I have written out the equivalent definitions of a normal subgroup, and in the last lecture we proved that if a group is abelian then every subgroup of it has to be normal. Let's look at yet another result. Suppose H is a subgroup of G and index of this subgroup is 2, then H has to be a normal subgroup of G. Now recall that we have done index in the last chapter, and there we defined index of a subgroup as the number of distinct left cosets of H in G or the number of distinct right cosets of H in G. Both are the same. So we look at number of distinct left or right cosets of H in G, and this number is called as the index. And if the group is finite, we also have a nice formula for the index. If the group is finite, then the index of H in G is simply the order of the group divided by the order of the subgroup. So for us, index is 2 means there are precisely 2 distinct left or right cosets of H in G. So let's begin with that fact. So let us assume that H is already a subgroup of G and the index of this subgroup in the group is 2. So that will mean there are precisely 2 distinct left or right, for that matter, cosets of H in G. So because the index is 2, there will be precisely 2 distinct left or right cosets of H in G, and our aim is to prove that H is a normal subgroup of G. So we wish to prove that H is a normal subgroup of G, and therefore from here, this time I pick this result. I will prove that every left coset of H in G has to be equal to corresponding right coset. So the way we are going to go about it is, H is a subgroup of G, and I have to prove that every left coset is equal to every right coset. That means GH is equal to HG for all elements G in the group capital G. Now this element G, small g, may either lie inside the subgroup or it may lie outside in the group, but outside the subgroup. So G could be either inside H or it could be outside H. I will prove that in both cases, the left coset has to be the same as the right coset. So firstly, we look at the easy case. Suppose the element G that I take lies inside the subgroup H. Then I have already proved this as properties of cosets in the last chapter, that if an element lies inside the subgroup, then the left coset generated by that element has to be the same as the subgroup. And I have also mentioned repeatedly in the previous chapter that whatever properties I prove for left cosets also hold for right cosets. So in this case, the right coset will also be equal to H, and therefore automatically the left coset will be equal to this right coset. So for elements which lie inside the subgroup, left coset is equal to right coset for all such elements. Now let's look at the case when the element G does not lie inside H. Well, if the element G does not lie inside H, look at the left coset GH. Look at the left coset GH. We know that the element G can be written as G times C. It can be written as a product of two elements where this element belongs to H because H is a subgroup. So clearly the element G lies in the left coset GH. the element G lies in the left coset GH. Also, I am assuming that G does not lie inside H. Remember, I had mentioned that whenever convenient, I am going to look upon H as a left coset. Whenever convenient, I am also going to look upon it as a right coset. So here, I look upon H as this left coset, EH. So this is a left coset, GH. This is also a left coset. There is an element which lies in this left coset, but it does not lie in this left coset. So this tells me that these two cosets cannot be identical, because there is one element which is here, which is not here. And I know that two left cosets have to be either disjoint or identical. So more importantly, now because they have one element which is here, which is not here, they cannot be identical. Therefore, they have to be disjoint. So if you look at the left coset, GH and H, these two cosets are disjoint. And now I use the fact that the index of H in G is 2. So I know that there are precisely two distinct left cosets of H in G. These two cosets are different. And there are precisely two distinct. So it has to be these two. So these are two distinct left cosets of H and G, and these are the only two left cosets that we will get because the index is 2. There is also a result on cosets which tells us that a group can be written as a union of all distinct left cosets of H and G. So we can write G as because these are the only two distinct left cosets of H and G, and a group can be written as a union of its distinct left cosets. So G can be written this way. Now whatever argument I have used for left cosets, precisely the same thing also works for right cosets, and therefore I will also get, remember I can look upon H as a right coset also. So this is what I will get if I repeat the argument for right cosets. So group can be written as a union of its distinct right cosets. So now I have a situation where I have A union B equal to A union C, because if you look at these two equations, left hand sides are equal. So, right hand side should also be equal. So, it is like A union B equal to A union C. However, from this, do not wrongly conclude that B is equal to C. Because, for example, if you take A as, say, 1, 2, B as 2, 3, 4, and C as 1, 3, 4, you can do the math for yourself. A union B will be 1, 2, 3, 4. A union C will also be 1, 2, 3, 4. But B is not the same as C. So do not wrongly conclude from this that B is equal to C. But here it's not working in this example because A and B, A and C have something in common. So if it so happens that these sets are disjoint, so if A union B is equal to A union C and these two sets are disjoint, they don't have anything in common. These two sets are disjoint, they don't have anything in common. Then B has to be equal to C, because it's like two pieces giving you the same picture. One piece is common. These two pieces have nothing in common. So B has to be the same as C. So using this extra condition that these two are disjoint, these two are also disjoint, they don't have any elements in common. Therefore, I can conclude that B is the same as C, which in this case will mean that GH is the same as HG. So, even when my element is not inside H, left coset is going to be equal to right coset. So, irrespective of whether G lies inside H like case 1, or G is not inside H like in case 2, left coset is equal to corresponding right coset therefore H has to be a normal subgroup of G. Well, what about the converse of this? Suppose H is a subgroup which is normal, does its index have to be 2? The answer is no. Remember the group Z6 that we tackled in an earlier lecture. For this, if I take the subgroup H equal to 0 bar 3 bar, then this is a normal subgroup of Z6 because Z6 is abelian. Let's look at the index of this subgroup, order of the group divided by order of the subgroup. So 6 upon 2, this is 3. So this is a subgroup which is normal, but its index is definitely not 2. So converse of this theorem is not true in general. But this tells us the result in one way. If you have a subgroup and that subgroup is such that its index is 2, then it has to be normal in G. So let's use this in an example. Normal subgroup of Sn for all natural numbers n. Sn is the group of symmetries of set containing n elements, and An is the set of all even permutations in Sn. Now the best thing to do if at this stage you do not recall what is An, what is Sn, is to go to the chapter on permutation groups and just go through the videos quickly so that you will recall. Now in that chapter I have already proved that An is a subgroup of Sn. Please keep in mind that when you want to prove that something is a normal subgroup, your first step should be to prove that it is a subgroup. Because only if it is a subgroup with some extra condition, then it becomes normal. So we must prove that An becomes a normal subgroup. Before I prove that An is a normal subgroup, I must prove that An is a subgroup of Sn. But I am borrowing this result from an earlier chapter. So I already know that An is a subgroup of Sn. From the same chapter, I also know that the order of the whole group is n factorial. Whereas, we have proved that exactly half the number of permutations are even. So the number of elements in An is n factorial upon 2. And therefore, if you look at the index of An in Sn, you will get, do the calculations, order of Sn divided by order of An. This is a subgroup with index 2, and therefore by using this theorem, An will be a normal subgroup of Sn. You can also prove that An is normal by using the definition in terms of elements. Of course, there you will require properties of odd and even permutations. But this proof is also easy. But because I did this theorem, I was tempted to immediately look at this example. So the set of even permutations is not only a subgroup of Sn, it is in fact a normal subgroup of Sn. That's all for now. We look at some more properties in the next lecture. Thank you.